this is a second imaging application, also from Hongbu Synthesis. You've seen me talk about this a little bit before, predicting the seasoning level of the snack food. But I don't think you probably really anticipated how much complexity there is underneath just going from the image and getting a prediction Y out at the end. There's actually a lot of work done in the intermediate steps. And in fact, the steps I will show you today are even still a condensed version. There's several more complicated algorithms that are used in the actual implementation. What I'm going to show is, I think it's version 5 out of 6. So Hongbu's thesis considers 6 different ways to predict the seasoning. And then the 6th method is the method that's actually used in practice. But there's a lot of additional complexity in there, which really doesn't really help us too much in this course. But certainly it's not something that would be difficult for you to go read if you go read a journal publication or the thesis on it. So I'm just going to show a slightly reduced version to illustrate the concept of using the score space rather than the image space to make a prediction. So whenever you're trying to apply multivariate image analysis or any image analysis tool for a real-time system or to achieve some sort of objective, the first thing to go do is, can I actually achieve it? Here we're showing is images with no seasoning all the way up to higher and higher seasoning at the end. So this is totally unseasoned product. This is the raw snack food with no seasoning applied to it. And this is the final, this is in fact over-seasoned product. They wouldn't normally sell this. So what you're hoping to see visually is, can I actually even see a difference in those images going from left to right? Okay, and if you can't see any difference, there's likely very little chance of success. It's not impossible, but if you can't spectrally or visually see in the wavelengths any difference, it's going to be a hard task. So here in this case, there is actually a distinction as you go from left to right. It seems a little bit washed out here on the projector screen, but on my computer screen here, probably in your notes, hopefully, you should see a fairly strong distinction as you go from left to right. You're shaking your head, Jake, you know?
No, it's the toner is running
out. Oh, the toner is running out.
Really, I'm just going to wash it out.
Everything's washed out. Okay, so first step is removing the background. The really tough part with imaging any product that's not lying down uniformly and facing the camera is the fact that you're going to generate shadows. So these snacks, shadows over here everywhere in between those gaps. And in this particular example, the belt that the snack food is moving on is also a dark color. You don't notice it too much because the coverage in this image is pretty much 100%. But being able to separate out snack food from non-snack food is really tough in the image space. Okay. In the original space, it's extremely tough. For example, can you see where the belt is in that image up at the top left? But over here in the segmented image, you're seeing just that corner over there. There's the belt shining through. It's the same level of darkness as some of the other shadows that you're seeing. But over here, that region of the image and a few of these gaps really represents a total absence of snack food. Where if I tried to do that in the original image, I may say all of this dark region over here is non-snack food, but it really isn't. Those are snack food pixels, but they're just in the shade, or in the shadow rather. So they still fall under this mask, under the green mask, but the pixels totally outside that mask. So there's a few over here in this training image. Those correspond entirely to the belt or non-product pixels. So the very first step is to take this, and in the software, you can try this. You can click on the snack food images. They'll land up over here in this mask. Non-snack food pixels will land up outside this mask. And so we just use that algorithm I showed there earlier, where you apply this mask. Once you've built it on the training data set, now you can use it for the future, for future testing images. So here's a future tested image coming in. I apply that same mask. Notice the vertices and shape of that mask are identical. And every pixel over here in my testing image, I go and find its corresponding T1, T2 location in the score image. And then I go map back pixels under this green mask. I go color-coded as green back in the original image. Pixels outside the mask, I've left coded as they originally appeared. And you can quite easily see someone's hand in the image. Okay. So they've picked up someone's hand coming into the field of view. They're taking a sample, which they do on this process every few minutes. But here, it's very clearly picked it up, whereas in your original image, you may not have quite seen that. Okay. And in fact, if you had left those fingers in there, they would have biased the prediction results from the image. So it's very important to segment any non-pixel image. So even, any non-snack food pixel. So our training data set consisted only of snack food versus non-snack food. We found a mask that covers only snack food. In the future, when we test it, any snack food pixel will land up in this mask. Any non-snack food, no matter what it is, a hand, the belt, a piece of paper, any non-snack food pixel will show up outside this region. And will be highlighted. In fact, then what Hongmu does going forward here is any pixel that's not highlighted in green is ignored. So we ignore the pixels of the hand, we ignore these pixels corresponding to the belt in the future calculations. We only use image pixels going forward from this point. So it's the very first preliminary segmentation step. Then what we go do is we calculate score plots for the different levels of seasoning. So here's four particular examples. The first two correspond to no seasoning. That isn't a mistake, it is no seasoning, and then the second one is also no seasoning. But the reason for showing two particular images are, these are two very different images, very different layout and presentation of the food here in the first two images, but their score plots virtually identical, which is great, as they should be. So we expect that stability in our score space, even though our image space is very dynamic and changing. You'd be hard-pressed for non-experts to maybe tell that these two are necessarily the same seasoning. But in the score space, the appearance of the scores are identical for all non-seasoned products. As we apply seasoning to the food, that score space starts to shift. So shifting in this diagonal direction. As more seasoning is applied to the food, notice that this location, I really should have drawn some grid lines here to help illustrate that, but that clustering has shifted over further down. And then for this case of very high seasoning, it's even more so. And that's kind of expected because of the spectral variation. We know that as we apply seasoning to the food, the spectrum is varying. And so if the spectrum is varying, and we know that PCA on this image data captures spectral variation, we should see that over in the corresponding scores. Two images that have the same spectral signature, no seasoning and no seasoning, should have the same appearance in the score space. Okay, but as you get different spectral appearance going all the way from left to right, we expect to see a variation in some direction of the score space. So Hong, you notice that that direction, as you add seasoning to the food, this is shifting in this diagonal direction. So one way is to try and quantify where those pixels lie in the score space and count up how many pixels there are in certain regions. So what she did was she divided the score space up in this sort of diagonal fashion, drew these parallel lines, and there's 32 bins created in the score space to span the entire possible region, all the way from no seasoning to maximum seasoning. And what she goes and does then is she counts up the fraction of pixels in the image that fall in each bin. So in this one, two, third bin, those first three, four bins, they almost have no percent of the image space falling into them. The fifth bin starts to have some very small percentage of the total pixels in that bin, and then it moves over here. And images with higher values of seasoning, we know that that cluster's moved further down. So we should see these bins over here have more pixels than the pixel bins up there. And in fact, if you plot this fractional histogram with the bin number on your x-axis, we see that for an uncoded image, that's the sort of distribution in the bins. As we get to high and high seasoning, these are the higher bin numbers further down here, where the score space is shifted. That histogram of the bin counts, or fractional bin counts rather, has shifted over. Now, I'll describe several other grading methods, and those are in the journal publications and thesis, which are available to you on the website. Finally, what she goes and does is her X-space feature vector over here now is a vector of 32 columns, one for each bit in the histogram. And she went to go use, the fraction of pixels like that. She just calculated the cumulative histogram. So if you read her thesis and you look at some of the histograms there, a low seasoned product or unseasoned product would have a histogram, cumulative histogram of that type. Medium seasoning would be like that, and then high seasoning would be like that. So she just calculates the cumulative histogram from this fractional histogram. But really, they're the same sort of thing. I'd have to check with her. I don't think there'd be too much of a difference in your model's predictive ability if you went to go use this as your X space versus the cumulative histogram. I think the only reason why she used the cumulative histogram is because maybe slightly less noisy from the summation. So that may have canceled out some of the noise. I think that was the reason for her using the cumulative histogram. But I'll have to double check. Maybe it is in her thesis, so I'll have to ask her. Either way, at the end, you've converted your pixels now. You've done your segmentation, calculated only pixels that you know belong to the product, discarded non-product pixels, calculated features from the product pixels, 32 of them, and your Y variable corresponds to the level of seasoning that you know from the training data set. At least you know in your training data set they did an experiment on the process and they knew what the Y variable was. In this case, the seasoning. From 32 features. Now, as expected, these 32 columns in your X matrix are extremely collinear because the count from one bin to the neighboring bin is going to be extremely similar. So extremely collinear X space. You've got no hope of getting a good predictive model from those features and using multiple linear regression. So you have to use a tool that handles the collinearity in X space, which is PLS in this particular instance. Here's the result. The triangles represent the training data. The squares are the testing data for this very small subset. In her journal publications, you can go see more illustrations of where they went to go apply this for longer time periods on their process. But this is just for a very small subset of data. So pretty good predictions. And the company was very happy with this and in fact went ahead and put it online. At that point in time. After they did that, Hong Lu realized, well, you know what, we could go look back at the method that we developed, and you realize that algorithm can be applied to an image of any size. So Hong Lu built it on images, I think, that were 640 by 480 pixels, but there's nothing in the algorithm that requires the image to be of that size. You can go apply that algorithm to a pixel, to a single pixel, or you can go apply it to a 10 by 10 image, or a 640 by 480, or even a 1 megapixel image. You get the same result, or it can be used just the same. So what Hong Lu went to do in this particular illustration here was she applied the algorithm just to that first pixel in the image and gets the corresponding coding value. Then goes to the second pixel, puts that in as a new data point, and gets the prediction of the seasoning. Moving through the entire image, you can calculate the predictive seasoning at every single pixel location. And we've shown it here as a color-based number. So blue or black colors would represent no seasoning, and red would represent high levels of seasoning. Solid black represents background, or it would be pixels that weren't considered food product. So this is great because they now display this at the operating line. There's a video monitor on the operating line that shows you this predictive seasoning. Much, much more clearer visualization to the operators on how the seasoning is distributed over the entire belt of product passing by. You can also, as I said, apply that algorithm to a small subset of the image, and you calculate the predicted Y value for that little group. You can go color code that same block over here. Whereas another block over here has much greater seasoning value, you're predicting still a single Y value for that group of pixels, and it's got a higher seasoning value. Or you can reduce the size of your squares and keep going. Basically, the extreme is as you divide your pixel, your image up in smaller and smaller sizes, you get back to the case where each of your blocks is a 1x1 pixel, which is back to this case. Each pixel is individually predicted. That's a lot of computational work. You can get a much, much faster answer or a quick approximation to the distribution of seasoning by using what Holman Loop calls in the thesis the small window strategy. And you just try a few of them, and you start to see diminishing returns by going to a higher and higher level of resolution. You can tell even from this pixel representation that you don't quite have a uniform seasoning over there. And you can even tell which regions of the image are low seasoned and high seasoned. Sure, if I go to a smaller window, it takes longer to get this result, but I get a very similar answer. So there is some trade-off there. And what they do now, in fact, is they use a medium-sized window, and they calculate the variance of the seasoning. So every seasoning value that's predicted here, you calculate the variance. So not only do they get a prediction of seasoning, but they also get a prediction of the variability of the seasoning. And they monitor that on a control chart. So you're not just trying to predict from images just a single number. It's also, if you reapply your algorithm multiple times to subgroups of the image, you can actually calculate a variance from it, or a standard deviation, which can be quite useful. Okay, so I think I've covered most of this here in summary. We've removed the background, which has a different spectral signature. Our score space is always stable, despite the variability of the dynamic image space. MLR would definitely fail for these very collinear features. You can get a variance prediction. And what's interesting now, this is the part I worked on with Hong Lu and Dr. McGregor for some time. We wrote some software for Frito-Lay. It's well known that this is Frito-Lay's work. They published the journal publications are with Frito-Lay on this. We wrote the software. This is now rolled out to many of their facilities. I think even as far as in Canada, they use this, but certainly many of the United States production facilities, this is where it was first used. And then ProSensus, the company whose software we're using this course, they've kept on going through the lane, have probably made multiple improvements to this since then. But this work started originally from Hong's thesis back here in 2000 to 2003. Any questions on that particular application? Yeah. It's a very, very powerful company, uses it quite a bit, and it's surprisingly robust in terms of its predictive power. The only thing they do have to do from time to time is they have to recalibrate their models. So because they use the same production line to process multiple snack food types, so as you know, Frito-Lay doesn't just produce one type of food, they've got multiple different grades, they have to, before they change over to a new grade, they put a few, they keep them in reference bags of snack foods, or unseasoned and high seasoned foods. They've got a few levels in between. They present those to the camera sequentially, take those, and then recalibrate the model. Just because from day to day the lighting variance has changed, maybe if they replace the camera, the algorithm won't be appropriate to the new camera, so they have to recalibrate it for the new camera. So there's that work that has to be done. It's like any sort of instrument. that needs to be calibrated from time to time, except this one has to be probably calibrated more than they would like. Certainly that was the top request from Frito-Lay was, can you get this for us so that we don't have to redo the calibration every day? I don't know if that problem has been solved yet. This slide is out of place. This should have been back earlier. Okay. How are we doing for time? Okay, yeah, we're on track to finish up. This is the last application I'll look at. This, we're trying to move away here now from multivariate images in this application. In fact, this application is purely on grayscale images. But the reason why I chose to look at this application from June's work is because it highlights and just rounds up this concept of extracting features from images. That's sort of two things from today's class are important. One is the mechanics of applying PCA onto image data. But the other thing that I find more important is extracting features from the data set so that we can predict a wider variable later on. And the reason why I picked this case study to look at is because it looks at some other different interesting features to calculate. But June's thesis, if you ever have a chance to read, if you want to read some really interesting work, he's got multiple chapters. This chapter 8, his thesis, he looks at manufactured countertops. So this is the sort of countertop you'd walk into Home Depot or any of these home stores where they sell synthetic countertops. So this is not a natural product. This is a manufactured countertop where the aim is to make it look like a natural product. So they take plastic, they take stone, and they mix these products up, and they sand them down to generate a fake countertop. And there's certain criteria. People are very picky when it comes to buying these things. Like, so they don't want the details to be too fine, too high a contrast, too coarse. Also, if lumps of the material cluster together, so you get a whole black patch over here, then it's kind of frowned upon, or certainly it's not going to be as valuable to the company. So being able to manufacture the countertop to get the appearance looking good is extremely important. So June's thesis goes, and maybe I'll probably take this up in the last class, he actually goes much further than just monitoring the appearance. He actually goes back to how the countertop was produced and shows how they can make changes to the process to get the countertops produced correctly. He also does the same for injection molded panels. The other application he worked on was on froth flotation, was to predict whether the bubbles are poorly loaded with metal, well loaded, or overloaded. So I actually, after June developed this technique, I went up to Quebec to the company that gave us the original images, and we implemented it online there for a couple of days with the operators. And the operators had a T1, T2 score plot. I didn't think this would work, but I was surprised that it did. The operators had a T1, T2 score plot that showed them, so sort of this region was poorly loaded, this was well loaded, this was where they wanted to be, this was overloaded, and basically this quadrant, you couldn't ever get a high value of T2 and a low value of T1, so it's impossible to operate in this region. But we did some design experiments where we changed the chemicals added to the flotation cell. And as we were doing that, we were showing the operator how the image, so every image had a location in the T1, T2 score plot. And as he was making changes to the process, it would move around the T1, T2 score plot. But by the end of the third day, we asked him, well, can you adjust the process so it gets back to this desirable region? And because he had seen a visual representation of his changes and how they affect the appearance of the froth, he had learned what moves him in this direction, he had learned what moves him in that direction. And so if you ask him, well, you're over here now, get me over there, he knew what to change. And so it was quite easy for them to manipulate the process to get to the desirable operating point in T1, T2. We never thought this would work because you don't ever see a two-dimensional monitoring chart in any companies. You always see a one-dimensional. Everyone likes to think univariately in companies. And to take an unskilled operator who hadn't even finished high school, we were showing him this, and he was able to get it done and figure it out how to work it in quite quickly. So that was some interesting work there. But we won't talk about that today. We are going to quickly look at and finish up with is an application here from closer to home of steel. So the aim is, when steel is produced, you always want to produce a surface appearance on the steel that's smooth with very minimal pitting. So at the end of the production run, they'll cut off a certain piece, a certain size of this rolled steel, and an operator or a trained person will examine it to classify it as good, medium, bad, and they have another grade called excellent. So there's four categories: excellent, good, medium, and bad. And bad quality is many holes with fairly large pit sizes. So the smaller those holes or the fewer they are, the higher the quality of that steel and the more value you can get for it on the market. So size and severity of the pitting is what you're visually trying to look for in the image, or certainly not us, but an operator who's trying to characterize this steel. Those are the two major features, size and severity of the pits. And what June had available to him was 35 grayscale images. So we're not dealing with a multivariate image here, we're just dealing with a single, flat, two-dimensional matrix. And he had 35 images from four groups. Now, ideally, we would have liked to have some images set aside for testing. But what he did here, how the data were acquired was they wipe black ink onto the surface of the steel, and then they pour it on and then wipe it off. As you wipe it off, some of the ink remains in those pits and emphasizes them to you. So if you didn't do that, you would not see visually the contrast too well between pits and the surface. But by applying ink and then wiping it off, what remains is the ink in the pits and emphasizes the poorer quality. So the operator is looking for the visual appearance, size and severity, and the number of those pits. Really, the operator or the person who's judging the steel is interested in the texture of that steel, is how we would say it. So texture is the visual appearance of a product. How would you quantify texture? I'm going to give you 2-3 minutes. I want you to think about it a little bit, because you could do this. Have any of you heard of or done wavelet analysis? Okay, so even if you've read ahead in the notes and figured out how June did it, that's not the answer I'm going to take from you. What I want you to think about is how you would take a matrix, a two-dimensional matrix, just a single layer, and these are numbers that vary between 0 and 255. So you've got your usual number of rows and columns. Inside those rows and columns are entries between 0 and 255 that represent and make up, let's say an image of bad quality product. How would you use those matrix of numbers to judge the quality of the steel? How would you try and predict from that matrix whether it's a good quality, medium, or bad? I just want you to think of different ideas for a couple of minutes, and then we'll discuss what you come up with.
So I'm wondering, in Any ideas, guys?
Small box, what about, like the average box?
She had a lot of very.
You're trying to get a gradient back to that.
So how would you try to get that numerically?
So gradient.
That would work, but that, so.
Remember, this is not all bad computer, that matrix of numbers.
If it was all.
How do you extract from that matrix of numbers?
But a lot of logic, that's like, take.
Well, let's check the logic.
Oh, sorry, a lot of zeros.
Some matrix.
And then take the average of each of those, and if there's a lot of variation between those.
Because it doesn't.
Smaller or not.
Because if you put a lot of flying straight along, though, we put one monster small.
That was like a monster spot, like, what is it?
The good one's pretty uniform. What you're looking for is.
Everyone, but how would you tell bad from her?
Why is that?
I don't know.
Does it, maybe, once you have that.
So either you expect a monster zero, like, right? Or you could, but like, what gradient you just have?
Okay, so how would you do that? How do you convert that in English to a computer code?
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm.
I don't know. Yeah, I have a thought.
I say, like, one
question. Are you saying, like,
I think you're referencing that.
Well, yeah, that was
why can't we do it like we were doing for the previous two cases where it was just a T1, T2 score?
Okay, yeah, I'll talk about that in a minute. Because that was, think of it this way. What if you're going to need the same number of black and white pixels? It's just the size of it is different. So the same total number of black and white, but they're just distributed differently.
Oh, so one measure shadow.
So how can shadow survive?
I think one thing to think about is the following.
Just a second. Think about it this way. Let's say the medium and the good image have the same number of dark pixels and light pixels, but they're just distributed in a different manner. So you can't say, I'm going to tell the grid from medium by just counting the total number of dark pixels and saying if it has more dark pixels, it's medium. But let's say, for example, good and medium have the same number of dark pixels, but it's just the distribution of them that's different. What I'm interested in, how do you quantify that distribution so that you can make a prediction of the medium and how the good? Okay, let's get some ideas. Matt, Brandon?
Alright, my idea is basically, well, our idea is sort of together. If you take and divide that into smaller sub-matrices.
Okay, so let's say this is the original image with, say, 500 pixels.
Alright.
And we divide this, say, into groups of 50, let's say.
Oh, go even smaller than that. I mean,
so columns of 10 and rows of 10?
Columns 10, rows of 10. And then if you, so
you've got
100
by 100, so sorry to interrupt you. You've got 100 by 100 matrix.
Yeah.
Sorry, 100 elements, 10 by 10 matrix. Yeah.
And then you're looking at the variance between those sub-matrices. Because in the bad case, you have larger specs, right? So when you make that smaller matrix up now,
so
those will show up as. There would be more variability in that group.
So you calculate the standard deviation of that 10 by 10 group?
Well, I'm talking about of each of the sub-matrices, so you're of 100. Right.
Yeah, so you calculate a standard deviation for this group, a standard deviation for the next group.
Well, what I'm thinking is if you take, oh, sorry, I skipped a step. You have to take the average of that subgroup,
yeah.
And then you're looking at the variation and the averages. So if you have a lot of variation in the averages, that indicates, you know, one subgroup had more black pixels than like in the good case, you'd assume maybe they're more, like since it's a finer thing, this doesn't make any sense. They're averaging out the more uniform.
I'm just thinking numbers. Because you're converting your problem from, say, a 500 by 500 matrix down to a 50 by 50 matrix.
Yeah.
And now you've got standard deviations rather than pixel intensities.
Yeah.
So yeah, sure, you made your problem smaller and you've converted it to something that's more meaningful. I like your thinking, but I'm still trying to think how you get to the end goal of now taking that 50 by 50 matrix of standard deviations and getting good,
oh, right,
medium,
but
bad, excellent.
So if you have that matrix of 50 by 50,
yeah.
And then you look at the standard like of those 50 by 50,
yeah.
Okay, and you have the averages of each of those 50 by 50.
Okay.
So 50 different averages. Then you look at the standard deviation of those averages. I don't know.
Okay, I know where you're going, and thinking, I like that. Yeah, so that's one option.
Okay.
Group here at the front, you guys had some interesting discussions.
So we're thinking of doing the same thing. We split it up into, say, 50 by 50 or 100 by 100. And what we were thinking is, if you wanted something that's well dispersed, and you say, like, the black points are, like, zeros,
yeah.
Like these come up, and the white ones are 2 to 55,
okay.
Then why not take all the pixels in that little group and add them all up?
Okay.
Right. Or actually, excuse me, before you add them all, just subtract like 130, so like the average, it looks gray. Right?
Yeah. So
and then add all
midpoint
those.
Midpoint 130. Okay.
And then square them, and then add them all up for each box.
So
and
that's the sum of squares around the mean, which is the standard deviation.
No.
I know. That's the thing. I have the same thing because I think about something like you just say. I verbalize it to myself, and I realize like, hang on, that's just the same thing. Right. Because but
what's wrong with summing up all the standard deviations? If you get a really high sum, then why is it?
Perfect. No, that's great. That's great. Yeah, it's definitely a valid approach. What I was trying to have you do is think through different approaches you might take. Right. So that's great. So you're saying you take those standard deviations and sum them, and if it's you then look at that sum and then lower standard deviations would mean a more uniform image, likely from a good quality product. Shavesh, Yao, do you guys have something? Harry?
Well, I think our idea is to create a new graph to create a new graph with the same size as the original graph for each pixel in the new graph. So we could count the number of the white points or the black points, I think the image is close to that pixel. That gives another graph.
Okay.
So if the point for two sample to that graph to be so the number of the number of the black points of white points for each pixel would be obviously it would be small for the meteor graph, for the new graph we created for the meteor sample. So the number of black or white points for each pixel would be large.
Okay. So you're going to do some summation and then you're going to judge the relative size of the sum for each of the categories, good, medium, bad, excellent. Sorry, I should have excellent at the top. Okay. So hopefully there's some sort of gradient where as you go from excellent to bad, you're seeing a differentiation. I think that's what you were getting at, Jake, right? Yeah, in your summation.
I think so.
Yeah, standard deviations there. You're all got great ideas here. Any other thoughts back there?
Yeah. A quick question. Just why would we put the standard deviation over the variance? What are the benefits to it?
No, not they're equivalent. The one's the square root of the other. So they're directly proportional. So, it's just standard deviation is usually more natural because it's a smaller number and it's in the same units as the original variable. In this case, the units are intensity variance, so it's not the intensity of the pixels, but it's, I tend to prefer standard deviations over variances. Okay. Okay, there was another hand back there. Abdul, did you guys have some?
We were thinking of just dealing with the luminescence. And the change from one pixel to the other would be like if you have a cluster that's black, like the change. Because if you have like different parts that are higher or lower, they're gonna have a shadow. So.
Okay, so you try look at like let's say you have a white pixel, you're gonna look at its neighbors are also.
Yeah.
White.
So okay. So if you have like some sort of like interpolation type of algorithm, then you could determine like around it what it should be like.
Okay.
And then if it's not. If it keeps on like the next four or five are black or whatever, then that means
it's more uniform, right? It's, if its neighbors are similar to itself,
yeah.
Then it's got more uniformity. That's a great idea, Charlene.
Oh,
is what you guys said. Yeah. So I like what you're thinking. What you'll find the hard part is taking your ideas, which firstly are very hard to verbalize. Even, right? You've noticed that a bit. It's tough to try and describe even back to me. What you're thinking. You know in your head intuitively what your brain is trying to do when you're differentiating across those different things. Hard to verbalize it, it's harder still to try and code it up. One other thing that I've seen used, this is by no means my idea, but is remembering these are numbers between 0 and 255. Take a particular column, okay? So I've got a column of, well, let's just take a particular row. Taking a row of pixels, those are numbers that vary between 0 and 255. Okay. And what I can do is calculate the mean, like I think you said there, it would be roughly 130. Okay. And I can go take this pixel value, and let's say it's 10, it's over there. Then the next pixel value is up here, and then so on. As I'm moving across, let's say this is obviously a darker zone, and as I'm moving horizontally, it's related to what you were saying there earlier, that your neighboring pixels are similar in intensity. So as I move across, I'm seeing similarity. Let's say I'm heading from a black or darker pixel to a white pixel over here. What I'll see is I'm getting brighter. So this image here is in fact about 500 pixels. So 10 pixels is a very, very narrow region here. So yeah, I'm stretching it out here quite a lot. And then maybe I'll go from white back to black again, and it will start to head down. Okay. What you can do is you draw this horizontal line at the mean. Let's say the mean is 130, and you just count the number of times you cross above and below. And the fewer times you cross, the more uniform you are. Right? The more times I cross, the more I'm changing. I'm changing very rapidly from black to white. The less times I cross, the bigger my blobs are. The more times I cross, I'm crossing many times, I'm actually more like to a good pixel. Then within each row, I go count the number of crossings, and then calculate the average number of crossings. Similar to what you were saying, you calculate the standard deviation, which I think those two features are actually quite similar. I would feel that they would be quite similar. But that's another way, right? So how you code these things up and how you try to do it and implement it, you can be quite inventive, and that's where a lot of the fun comes from with image processing.
Did you have some sort of like slope?
Absolutely. Yeah, calculate the gradients, the rate of ascent and descent, yeah. And then that would be proportional to the quality as well. So I really like the ideas that you guys have there. If anyone's interested, I can certainly try to find a few of these images and you can play around with them yourself. So I'll skip over this. What June did was he used what's called wavelet texture analysis. And what this does is it decomposes the original image into four other images. So the first image that it decomposes into is what's called your approximation image. That's in fact a low-pass filter followed by another low-pass filter. It forms a horizontal detail image. It forms a vertical detail image and a diagonal detail image. Now I'll show you what these look like. in the images that follow over here, I've combined the three detail images. I've combined the horizontal, vertical, and diagonal detail images together. And I've separated that from, so those are three images combined and the one approximation image. Now, there's my original bad image. This it happens to be a bad steel image. My approximation is a low pass filter followed by a low pass filter. So low pass filter, for those who are not familiar with that term, means you're allowing low frequencies in the signal. So as I go through my image horizontally and I calculate the frequency content in that signal of numeric values that range between 0 and 255, the lower frequencies are allowed to pass, and I filter out the high pass frequencies. The detailed image over here, as you can see, is a very, very fine image. There's a lot of fine, but it seems mostly dark, probably seems grayscale, solid grayscale to you in the back. But if you zoom in and look at the numerical values, say in MATLAB or some tool like that, you'll see that the numbers here change very rapidly. But they're all very close, they're close to each other numerically, but there's a lot of movement, there's a lot of randomness, a lot of high frequency noise in this image. In this image, very low frequency information is in your approximation. High frequency is in the details. Then you do another round of the wavelet decomposition, and this time you decompose A1. So the first approximation gets decomposed into a second approximation to that, and then an its associated detail image. So the sum of A2 and D2 gets you back A1. Same for the first case. Your original image can be reconstructed by combining your first approximation, the low frequency information, with the high frequency information. Put those two together and you'll get back your horizontal image. Pixel for pixel summation. Decompose A1 into a second approximation. So it looks similar to A1, but you see how it's kind of smeared and cruder approximation. And then you'll cart the leftover details. Decompose A2 a third time to get A3 and its corresponding details A3. And you can keep going with this. You'll end up here with A3 and A4. You finally take this fourth approximation and break it down the last time and see how crudely now we get A5. Very crude approximation to the original image. So seeing this clustering of white, a uniform white cluster surrounded by a U-shaped black cluster. Back in the original image, yeah, you can actually kind of see that, right? Now that you look at it back in the original image, you do see that U-shaped darker zone around a lighter, whiter zone. Which may not have jumped out at you in the original image when you just saw it for the first time, but once you calculate these approximations and details, that definitely sticks out. Now, we can go, these six images shown here are really just a complete summary of the original image. If I combine A5 with D5, I get A4 back again. Once I have A4, I combine it with D4 to get A3. Then A3 combined with D3 gets me A2, which combined with D2 gets me back to A1, and A1 plus D1 gets me back to my original image. So I've taken my original image and broken it down into six others, five details, and one very low-level approximation. Now you can see frequency content quite clearly in this image. And certainly in the five detailed images, you start to see the level of pitting and that whole texture now shows up very clearly. And there's been some studies to show actually that our eye and our brain processes images in a very similar way. If I look at this room, snapshot, I kind of see two clusters of things here, a blob there and a blob there. Then I can focus in on the desks, and then I can focus in on the people, and then I can focus in on your eyebrows. So I can go to levels of details beyond that. But my visual summary is just very, if I have to snapshot, look at something very quickly, I'm just going to see two blobs, and then more and more details fill in. So there is some evidence that our brain processes the image in the same way. Here, we're taking that steel image and breaking it down into five levels of detail and an approximation. and each detail image captures a certain frequency content of the original image. So what June went here, what June went to go do is he captures this frequency information in the five detailed images, and then he goes and extracts features from each of those subsequent grayscale images. So each of those are grayscale. We're not doing anything multivariate in this particular iteration. It's all just univariate single grayscale images. Any number of features could be calculated. The one that June used was the energy, the sum of squares, which is nothing more than standard deviation, or represents the variability within the image. Entropy, the sum of absolute values. An image with a zero entropy, this is actually incorrect, it's not a solid color. An image with entropy equal to zero is a black image. It's the sum of absolute values, zero, the only way you get that is that's black. You can calculate minimum and maximum, etc. You can be inventive here with your features that you extract. So June calculates five detailed images, and then actually each of those detailed images, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, they consist of a horizontal, vertical, and diagonal detail. When I showed you the detailed images, they were the summation of H, V, and D. But June's original calculation, he's got the energy in the horizontal image for D1, energy in the horizontal image for D2, D3, D4, D5. Same for vertical, same for diagonal. So 15 features per image are extracted. What you can see here is this distribution of energy shifts. As you go from excellent images from excellent quality steel surfaces to bad quality steel surfaces, you're going to higher and higher D levels. Going back here, that makes absolute sense. As we go to higher and higher D levels, our frequency information is getting high, from high frequency, medium frequency, to lower and lower frequencies. And so that's a good feature to extract. And if you look at that bar graph there, that could be a good way to try and tell the particular grading of the steel.
Is that more frequency of white or black?
No, it's a frequency. It's not white or black. So we have to be careful here. These are grayscale images, so they're not white and black. That would be a binary image. This is a grayscale. It's 256 levels. We're saying the frequency, if you treat those grayscale values, the sequence of grayscale integers within a row or within a column, just treat them as a long vector, and you calculate the frequency content of that image, of that vector.
How high and low it might get?
No, well, frequency refers to, if something moves like that, you say it's high frequency. If it moves like that, it's low frequency. So it's referring to how rapidly the values are changing from one to the next, sequentially. So there's definitely a spatial aspect to it, which is, texture is a spatial feature, right? Texture is, if I ask you to quantify the texture, it's a spatial two-dimensional a quantity from that image. Texture is definitely a spatial feature. So you have to extract features that are spatially relevant, which is why multivariate image analysis actually wouldn't work on this. Firstly, we don't have a multivariate image. But even if we did, multivariate image analysis extracts spectral information. What we're interested in this problem is spatial information, texture, pixel-to-pixel location information. What was really interesting is that if you go and take those features, those 15 features, and you just dump them into a matrix and perform PCA on that, they separate out very naturally into these groupings of bad, over here, medium here, good over here, and excellent. There's a bit of misclassification here. A few of the excellents fall into the good category. And as June notes in his thesis, though, the visual difference between good and excellent is extremely hard to tell. So it could be just misclassified by the original person. So that's not surprising. But what is surprising is, without telling us, the PCA doesn't know, right? PCA doesn't know that particular row is from good steel or bad steel. There's no telling the model what this observation is. But if you put in those 15 features, they naturally separate out into those four groupings. The lines I've added manually afterwards, or you added them in his thesis here as well. But it's interesting that they just fall so naturally apart. So this is a nice little proof of concept study because it indicates you could take your image, calculate these features on it, and then find the T1, T2 value of those features and then make an automatic judge of the quality of that steel surface. Okay, just I know we're over time by a few minutes, so I'll just wrap up here. The same things that I've noticed before, if you ever go ahead and do an image project, your biggest nightmare is getting the lighting right. I cannot emphasize that enough. They say if you're in real estate, it's location, location, location. For image analysis, it's lighting, lighting, lighting. For example, that surface pitting on the steel. June emphasized that because they rubbed ink onto the steel and then wiped it off. But if you wanted to examine those steel sheets, practically thinking, you've got the steel running by on a high-speed line, you don't have the ability or the cost even to put ink on and wipe it off again. Okay? The ink being wiped on and off is purely to help the operator or the person judging the quality of the steel. But from a practical implementation point of view, you can't have that. So how might you try to do your lighting so that it actually emphasizes the pitting for you? Any ideas?
You have the lighting at an angle?
Yeah, very, 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 very obtuse, oblique angle coming in there to really emphasize all the shadows from the pitting. And the biggest problem with lighting like that is that you get a hot spot on your image. This is a very reflective surface, and you actually see the light reflected in the steel. So you have to have very good diffuse lighting. That kind of, it's almost like sunlight, where it's uniform from all angles. Whereas a spotlight is just a single point radiating out, and you see that reflected. It's extremely tough. Diffuse lighting is so hard to get right. And companies that will do it right will charge you a lot of money. It's really, really hard. I can't emphasize that point enough. I've spent so much time with cheap companies that refuse to spend money on lighting, and then you have to try and fix up the lighting in an algorithm. It's a mess. It's tough. Okay, the other problem is even if you get the lighting right, there'll be extra lighting from sunlight coming in or ambient lighting in the room that changes. So you have to recalibrate periodically. So some ideas you can use is you can put a background belt in there where you know what that background should be, and you can recalibrate periodically. So if you know the background should be, say, RGB should be have certain RG and D values, you can recalibrate your camera to make sure you get that. Or another thing that's often used is that the color cards of known spectral intensity, kind of just off to the side of the camera in the field of view, and then you can recalibrate those from time to time. So Zheng did his master's thesis here at Mac on near infrared cameras, and he did some nice study on how to calibrate for that. The other thing that's really annoying is that if you replace that camera, you get a totally different set of pixels. Even if you keep the image exactly the same and have two cameras take an image of the same product with the same lighting, you'll get totally different pixels. It's really annoying to work with that problem. And that's not an easy problem to solve. I don't know anyone who's done work on that. Okay, so just to wrap up here, this slide is mainly saying feature extraction is the critical step. Got to extract features that are relevant to your problem. Like you saw both in the seasoning and in the surface appearance, your features, what you extract is going to be the judge of how well your performs at the end. So what we'll do next week is I'll probably do a class on classification.